Ham Radio Now, episode 48. Can never quite get enough of that. This one is on the digital voice access point dongle, or the DVAP. Another talk from the ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference down in Orlando last September. And this one presented by Moe Wheatly, AE4JY. But before we get to that, well, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Sitting in the chair behind me, just kind of out of reach, is the bear. You can't see him, but you should know he's there. So before we get to this episode, I need to do a quick update on episode 47, where we covered HF Digital Voice. And in that program, we headlined a software program called FDM-DV. And I even screwed up the name of that program. A viewer pointed out that that has been renamed to FreeDV. And we can take a look at their website. It's the same program, just a new name. And they even have a short video to demonstrate it. And I thought maybe we'd take a look at that.
Hey, Zero PFX, this is M4DVR. The name here is Jerry. I'm located near Tampa, Florida. We're using open source FreeDV. That's with Codec 2. The bandwidth on this mode is about 1.1 kilohertz. We're going to make a test here now. We're switching from digital FreeDV to analog sideband. Oops, stand by. It's in 4DVR. Okay, this is M4DVR doing the analog mode now. Just to give you an idea here of how much difference there is between sideband and digital. Okay, back to digital. Okay, codec and modem was developed by David Rowe. Graphics user interface by Dave Witten. Back to you, Mel. K0PFX N4DVR.
Well, as I listen to that demo, I've got to say that I'm not super impressed. Of course, the signal-to-noise ratio is really good, typical of digital voice. I'm not real impressed with the fidelity and the little fringiness around it, but I do have to note that, first of all, Codec 2 is still a work in progress, so they're still making improvements. And, of course, as he said, the bandwidth that they're using is just 1.1 kilohertz, so that's super narrow. And for that bandwidth, it's pretty impressive. You can download FreeDV and Codec 2 and use them today. The website there at freedv.org. You use the same sound card interface that you'd use for things like PSK31 and FL Digi. So not that hard to get set up. It feeds a signal into a typical single sideband transmitter, right into the microphone input or the auxiliary input, and you get the audio back out from the speaker jack, or once again, the auxiliary jack. So it operates with your radio in sideband mode. You can do it today. So get on digital voice. I think 14.236 is the frequency that most of the folks hang out on when they're doing digital voice. All right, on to the DVAP. Now, it's always a little bit hard to describe the DVAP. I've got one here. I think it might actually be a little bit easier for me to tell you what it does than what it is. And, of course, Mo is going to give you a significant detailed description of what it is and what it does and how it works. So let me just say that it plugs back there into the laptop computer. And it lets me use my D-Star handy talkie to talk through the internet into D-Star repeaters and reflectors that are all connected to the internet. And with the antenna that I've got on here, I've got a little bit bigger one than the stock antenna, but it works for a few hundred feet so that it covers my house and actually up and down the block a little bit. Some hams have put them on bigger base station antennas, and they've extended coverage out to about a mile. It is a 10 milliwatt transmitter. So, of course, instantly, hams think about, well, let's put an amplifier on it. Moe is going to explain why that's not a good idea, but basically it's got a little bit too much broadband noise, so you don't want to run it into an amplifier. The DVAP and the DVDongle have been important devices because even though D-Star is growing, there aren't D-Star repeaters absolutely everywhere. And most places that have them may only have one. So if you want to play a little bit more D-Star, then you might feel comfortable doing on your local repeater. If you want to bop back and forth from one reflector to another or from one repeater to another, and you feel you'd kind of drive the other D-Star users crazy on the local repeater, the DVAP and the DVDongle will let you do that all by yourself and not have to tie up the repeater and maybe irritate people. Although I know some D-Star repeater owners who say there's not enough activity on their local repeater, and they'd really appreciate you getting on there and giving it lots of activity. Now, usually when we hear about the DVAP and the DVDongle, we're hearing from Robin Cutshaw, AA4RC. Robin wrote the software for these devices. He's given a bunch of seminars, and we've even got a few of them on ARVN. And we have an interview with Robin on Ham Radio Now. We did that back on episode 20 at the Huntsville Ham Fest. So if you're interested in this and somehow you missed that interview, stop back at episode 20 on Ham Radio Now, and you can hear us talk to Robin. Somebody even complained that I said that Robin invented the DVAP and the DVDongle, and I might have put it that way at some point. But Robin's always careful to give credit to Mo, who did the hardware part of those devices, and Robin just did the software part. But he says that Mo tends to keep a lower profile. He kind of sits in the background. Well, in this episode, in this talk from the ARL and Tapper at DCC, Mo steps out of the shadows and tells us how he went about designing the DVAP and the DVDongle. So let's go down to Atlanta and the Digital Communications Conference, and we'll let Steve Bible introduce Moe Wheatly, AE4JY.
All right, continuing with the digital voice theme, we're proud to have Moe Wheatly, AE4JY, his talk, Digital Voice Access Point Dongle.
All right. Good afternoon. I'm, like you said, Moe Wheatly, AE4JY. And this call sign probably doesn't show up in too many of you guys' logs because I'm very inactive on the air. But I really get into designing and building hardware. That's kind of my thing. So that's what I do. Today I'm going to look at the digital voice access point dongle. If you guys are in D-Star, you probably know what it is. Primarily, what it is, it's a small, low-power GMSK transceiver on 2 meters, or right now we got a new one, it's on 70 centimeters. And the primary use for this is to connect into the D-Star network. And the way it works, it kind of looks like an access point, like a Wi-Fi access point, except it's on 2 meters, it connects to a PC and the internet. And by using your HT or your mobile radio, you can now talk to this low-power DVAP around your house and neighborhood and access the network and all the repeaters and reflectors that are out there. So you can, you know, walk around your backyard and basically talk around the world. I was going to talk a little about the history of this thing. Most of my projects don't start by somebody coming up and saying, you know, Robin didn't come up to me and say, Mo, I need a DVAP. Most of my projects come from, you know, scouring the internet for data sheets and looking at new parts and seeing what's out there. And what triggered this project was Analog Devices has, back in 2006, came out with this ADF7021, which is a single chip, complete GMSK transceiver, and that's what triggered this project. And also to light a fire under my behind was a Mini Circuits has a design contest, or did, back at the Southeastern VHF Society conferences. They had really good prizes. I think it was over $1,000 if you won the first prize. So anyway, that lit a fire to go ahead and try to get this chip implemented on some kind of a prototype. And this is what caught my eye as I, being a geek, I'm downloading data sheets instead of other things on the internet. And that's because I'm old, not because I'm a geek. But anyway, I've circled what caught my eye. First, there was the frequency range, 80 megs to over 900 megahertz. Now, if you're familiar with these little low-power transceiver chips, most of them are in the ISM band of like 400 megs, 900 megs, 2.5 gig. This caught my eye because it went down to 80 megs. So you go, oh, 2 meters is down there, you know, 220, 440. The other thing that catches your eye is it does, you know, 2FSK and MSK, which is just a subset of that. Also, it did the spectral shaping, the bit shaping, and you could do raised cosine or Gaussian shape. And then the data rates supported were, you know, really low to 24 kilobits. So put these all together, you could get 4,800 bits per second. There's a G, there's MSK, so you have GMSK, DMOD modulation, and it covers 2 meters, 440, and 220 for whatever that's worth. So anyway, that's what caught my eye on this. These are like the first page of a data sheet, and they're kind of funny because they're written really by marketing people. I always like terms like high performance, you know, what does that mean? But anyway, that was the part that caught my eye. And this is the project that I presented, and I called it DVX, Digital Voice Experimenter Board, and basically just wired up these components. Here's the analog devices transceiver chip. You know, it goes to an antenna. A little ARM7 microcontroller to do all the management. You know, serial port interface. Little LCD display. Some knobs. And don't get yelling at me, but I actually had an AMBI 2020 vocoder chip, which is used by the D-Star guys for their vocoder. And then a codec, which is just the A to D, D to A, to a microphone and a speaker. So all these components basically made a little low-power digital voice transceiver. And this is the circuit board. You can see some blue wires and other things, but it did work. And the way I do prototypes usually is try to spread things out. It makes layout a whole lot easier. So you see things are really spread out on a big board. I'm not trying to produce this. I'm just playing with things. So it's a lot easier just to spread things out. So you see here's the little analog devices, RF chip, BNC connector. Here's a little processor. Here's the AMBI vocoder chip. This is the first time I ever played with it. It has a gazillion different modes and jumper, you know, settings for stuff. So I just basically had a big array of resistors till I could set these lines high and low because I had no idea how it was supposed to work. Here's a little audio codec. Here's a microphone connector and then a speaker amplifier. So not a lot to it. Here was the enclosure and basically speaker, knob to control volume and set the frequency and a microphone input. Antenna and 12 volts in, and it did work. I mean, we made contacts on D-Star, but it's, you know, 10 milliwatts. You're not going to go very far. So here's what, even though this project had no commercial value, even as a kid, it didn't make any sense. I mean, who needs a 10 milliwatt transceiver to talk to somebody in your neighborhood? But what it did, it was spawned two different products. The first one, this was back in 2007, And 2008 came up with a DV dongle, which some of you may have heard about. Basically, all it does is take this Ambi vocoder chip, put a little processor to make the interface easier, so it looks like a serial port, put it in a box, and now you can just plug it into your PC and have access to this vocoder. And so you can listen to D-Star, talk on D-Star, just like voice over IP on your PC without even having a radio. So that's been fairly popular, especially for people that don't have a radio. It's a way to at least get into the D-Star network and play around. The other product that was spawned 2009, a year later, was this DVAP, which is what I'm going to talk about. And it basically got rid of the Ambi and now put the RF chip, transceiver chip, together with a processor, put it in basically the same package. And that was in 2009. This year, finally, after 3 long years, I finally got religion and got help on the RF side and got that working. Okay, I'm going to talk a little on the hardware. DVAP, go over the block diagram and physical layout and talk briefly some of the functions. This is the overall block diagram of the DVAP, and again, you got a little ARM7 processor, microcontroller. Here's the analog devices, RF, the transceiver, and a few other blocks. This is a USB, one of the FTDI USB to serial USB chips. This microprocessor has its own USB interface. The problem, or the issue, was I wanted to have a bootloader in here so that you could plug in and download new firmware. Well, if you put the USB stack inside here, and that's the only way you can talk to this chip, that means the bootloader has to contain the entire USB stack, which is probably more code than all the rest of this. And if there's a bug in that, you can't update it. So this allows you to use USB as a serial port and just directly go into the UART. Some of the other blocks has some E-squared to store some settings and calibration data. This is a little interesting stuff. I mean, I'm kind of agnostic when it comes to D-Star. I'm not a proponent or against it. But one thing that caught my interest was you can also do analog FM with this chip. So I added a few components to be able to do analog FM as well as the digital stuff. And to do that, you need a little analog filter to filter the discriminator data coming out of the chip, and also a DAC to be able to modulate FM onto the, make basically a VCO so you can modulate the carrier. And also there's a little relay driver that is kind of legacy that there's really no real use for it right now. This is the first DVAP prototype. And again, I kind of made it as a big board so it's easy to lay out. And here you see the processor, the analog devices chip, and it's in this big, relatively big case. Everything's spread out to make it easy to lay out. And then this is the final production board. In fact, this is the new version that we just came out with that has the fix to be able to do 70 centimeters. Here's the FTDI interface chip to the USB, and here's the processor. Here's the analog devices RF chip. Of course, that's a little crystal. This little chip is kind of neat. It's a little 8-pin chip. You put a crystal on it, and it's, it provides an oscillator, but it also has an analog VCO input. So you basically make a VCO out of these two chips using a normal crystal and this little chip. And here's a little 14-bit DAC that modulates the FM for the analog FM. And there's the E squared. Another new thing we added on the 70 centimeter board was this little 3-pin. It's a temperature sensor. Because 2 meters, you can almost get by without temperature compensated crystal oscillators. But on 440, there's just too much drift with temperature. So this feeds back adapts the reference clock. And of course, LEDs and all that good stuff. Other new thing we added, and this is what fixed the RF problem, was basically I don't know how to design RF filters above 100 megahertz or so. And this is a little neat little mini circuits part. It's a little filter, low pass filter, little surface mount. And that and some improved grounding around this connector is what got rid of some of the harmonic problems. And this is the final, what people normally see for the DVAP, the production. It's in a little plastic case. Okay, I won't spend much time. This is the processor. A little ARM7. It's actually, because this was all done back in mid-2000s. At that time, this was kind of a, not state-of-the-art, but it was kind of high-end for a microcontroller. It had an ARM7 and had lots of memory and stuff. Of course, now this is a very mature ARM processor. There's a lot of new ones out there. But standard stuff, memory, serial ports, all that kind of good stuff. Okay, now this is the block diagram of the analog, basically the heart of this thing, which is the analog devices transceiver chip. And the top is the receiver, basically RFN, little amplifier, and it has an image reject mixer, has I and Q, but they don't go to baseband. They go to 100 kilohertz for IF processing. And the reason for that is if you go to basically baseband, which is DC, and this is all analog, it's really difficult with DC to have high gain amplifiers at DC because they have to be DC coupled and you have offsets and stuff. So it's just easier to do that at a little higher frequency. You kind of see that with like the soft rocks, if you know, right in the middle where you're tuning, there's usually a hump or a dip or something because that's a DC signal you're trying to amplify. Then an IF amp and has a log amp to get RSSI information. Demodulator block, clock data recovery, and then in and out with the clock and data, the digital data that's demodulated. It also has AFC control, so it actually has a feedback mechanism to the PLL, so it can actually lock onto a signal that's not centered. And the bottom line is the transmit side. Basically, you take a bit stream coming in, you shape the bit, either Gaussian or raised cosine, in this case, Gaussian. And then the modulation control, you want 2FSK, and then a sigma delta modulator, which is part of the PLL, to do the GMSK modulation. On the RF side, there's actually two VCOs in this chip. One has an internal inductor, and it's, I think, runs from like 800 megs, 70 to 800 megs to 900 megs. And then you can divide that by two. But to get below 400 megs or so, you need an external inductor, and they'll use the second VCO to get the 2 meters or whatever. And then you have to have an external analog PLL filter. This is the RF front end. I won't bore you with this, it's kind of complicated because the RF input, the receiver, is a differential and it's not 50 ohms. It's some weird complex number and it changes whether you're transmitting or receiving. Same with the PA. The PA is some complex impedance that changes. And you could put a TR relay on here and make it right, but there's a cheap way to doing it. And you basically do a compromise match. You take the inductors and capacitors, and you try to get this point as close as you can to 50 ohms, whether it's in transmit or receive mode. And they have a program that will calculate those values. Or you can, if you don't trust them, do it yourself. I'm just gonna skip that. This is some RF stuff. This is a digital conference, so I won't bore you with analog stuff. Unless you want it. Okay, I'll talk about it. This is kind of a neat trick. I don't know if anybody's used LT Spice for And it's cool for doing voltage and currents and all that stuff, but I wanted to measure impedance. I have this, you know, complicated network, and I want to find the impedance at this node. And there's no function in LTSpice that says, here, measure the complex impedance of that node. And I Googled around, and on their forums, there's a little trick you do, which you drive this node with a one amp AC current source, constant current source, and then sweep the frequency of that, and voila, here's your frequency range. Replace the little voltage with ohms, so there's the magnitude, there's 50 ohms, and on the angle, there's your phase angle. So you go over, here's 50 ohms, here's the magnitude, it's close to 50, and the angle is close to zero. So this thing is fairly closely matched to 50 ohms. So anyway, that's a clever trick, I thought. Here's the GMSK demodulation. Actually has two different demodulators. It has a linear demodulator. This is a standard linear with frequency demodulator. Also has this thing called a frequency correlator, and they don't really tell how this works except to say it gets very close to the matched filter, you know, optimum matched filter demodulation of FSK. So that's maybe someday they will tell how they did it. And it actually tests, I've tried both, and it does have its, you know, 2 or 3 dB improvement in sensitivity. And then linears also use its feedback for the AFC of the VCO. Has a post demod filter, has also these different modes for different modulations. It can do 2, 3, or 4 FSK. The 3 FSK actually has a built-in the Turby detector. There must be some system out there that uses that, because it's, but anyway, for D-star, it's just straight 2 FSK. And clock and data recovery for the data. On the modulator side, basically data comes in, gets shaped Gaussian or raised cosine, multiplied by whatever your deviation is. And for this, you want a modulation index of 0.5 for MSK. And another thing that's cool is this is not analog. This is all digital. So you actually digitally modulate the PLL, the fractional divide by N for the PLL. So whatever you set as deviation is not temperature dependent or anything like that. And that's just standard PLL stuff. And this is what piqued my interest, was doing analog FM. And it has a test mode where they output right here before the data slicer, they output to a sigma delta DAC, one bit DAC, in 16 bits, although it's a one bit DAC, after the post demod filter. So this is like an analog looking at the discriminator. So basically at this point, you filter it with a little bit. That's analog FM, it works fine. Problem is there's no way to modulate analog FM on this chip. So what I did was just take this VCO I talked about, a little chip that basically is a VCO, voltage controlled crystal oscillator, and then modulate it with a DAC to get the FM modulation. And life's never fun. If you plot frequency versus voltage for the, like most VCOs, it's not linear. But what's cool, things called Excel, you take some data points, throw them into Excel, you get the correction curve for it. And I don't know if OpenOffice has it, but on Excel, it's called a trend line. You go in there and fit this to a polynomial, and like, poof, you have the equation for this line. Because I was dreading having to create 4,000 points into a lookup table by hand with graph paper like I used to do in the old days. So this was a godsend. Of course, I had to test the temperature compensation. So I pulled out the environmental chamber, but it was full of beer. And So the beer had to be removed and, of course, disposed of. So a couple days later, I was able to get the unit in this little refrigerator, monitor frequency, and take some data. And again, life's not good. It's not linear with temperature. So again, Excel to the rescue, and you get an equation and make a big lookup table, and life's good again. And it's really important on 70 centimeters, because I mean, even though this is the reference frequency, it's over extremes, it's a couple hundred hertz off. That's fine for D-Star and FM, but you know, multiply that up to 450 megs, suddenly this becomes kilohertz, and you got all sorts of problems. And this method, it works perfect for the unit you tested. I mean, you can get down to 100 parts per billion compensation. Go to the next unit, and it's like an order of magnitude worse. About the best you can do with this kind of compensation is maybe a factor of 10 better than that. But for this, it's fine. You go from 50 parts per million to 5, and it's probably fine. Okay, I'm going to talk a little about the firmware, and I'll talk development tools, a little bit about D-Star coding, encoding, a little about the analog FM, and then some features probably most people don't even know is in the DVAP. First, the development tools, I use the GCC compiler, but being a Windows person, I had to use a Windows build. Ugarto makes one. Just a binary for all the tools. Eclipse IDE, which has sort of become kind of the de facto standard now for embedded development for software. OpenOCD for the JTAG programming stuff, which is really only done once. Really, you just that's for the bootloader. Once the bootloader's there, then I don't really need it. I don't use any of the debug stuff. I'm really old school Neanderthal when it comes to debugging. Give me an oscilloscope and a serial port, and I'm happy. I spend more time trying to get OpenOCD for debugging, getting it all set up and not crashing, so it's just easier to use a scope. Some of you may be familiar, this is a D-Star data format. At the beginning, when you first key up your radio, what gets sent is this. First, there's a bit sync pattern, which is just one zeros. That gives time to find the center of the bit. And there's a frame sync, which says, hey, this is the beginning of this header, followed by the header data. Of course, it's error encoded. It's corrected. It's actually 660 bits that gets converted back to 328 of the actual data bits through FEC and all that good stuff. Then follow that as you're holding it down, talking or whatever, you have these frames, voice data frames, and they just keep repeating until you let go of the mic. And each of these frames is 20 milliseconds. There's 72 bits of voice data, 24 bits of what they call slow data. And at the end, this is where what it formatted is. There's 9 bytes of voice data per 20 milliseconds, and there's 3 user data bytes. And this whole thing is sent, it's on 20 millisecond timing. What's kind of bothers me about this is they put all this error correction, they've got interleaving, they've got all this stuff for the header to protect it, yet the voice data, they only rely on the AMBI. It has a built-in block FEC. I can correct, I think, 5 or 6 bits, which probably is fine. There's no interleaver, which I don't know if that's important on VHF. But what bothers me is the fact these user bytes are completely raw. I mean, there's no protection for these bytes. And to me, these are, in some cases, maybe the most important payload that you have. I mean, this has your call sign, but this may have information about, GPS data of where the tornado is or something. So to me, that was kind of a whole, kind of a maybe a little badness on the design side of D-Star. There's some user apps that have done it. They've tried to add FEC to this and error correction as a sort of an aftermarket thing. Okay, in the DVAP, basically the header decoder flow is simply, it's usually looking, it's just sitting there in a loop looking for the frame sync for the header. And if it finally finds one, then it just reads in the next 660 bits into a buffer, then goes, runs through this sequence, does a descramble, which is just XORing it with a scramble table. And that's just to mix up the ones and zeros. And then it does a deinterleave, followed by Viterbi decoder, and then it calculates the CRC, and if it's good, that says it's corrected enough bits, it's fine, then it goes on and starts reading voice data. Otherwise, it goes back and waits for sync. Also, there's sort of a parallel thing going on. You can actually, it's actually looking for voice sync as well. I didn't mention that in here. Every 21 of these frames, these user bytes get substituted by a sync pattern. So, and the reason for that is you may miss this header, but you want to be able to at some point catch up in the data and be able to at least listen to the voice, even though you've missed the header. Well, you may have turned your radio on while somebody's talking, so you've missed this header. So that allows you to sync up on these, at least on the voice data. And so parallel to this is running, you're also looking for voice sync. And if you see that, you kind of jump around this and look and start decoding the voice stuff. Encoding is just the opposite. Just run the thing in reverse. You calculate the CRC on your header data, encode it, interleave it, scramble it, and send it out. One of the more complicated things in the DVAP is the voice data jitter buffering. Probably didn't have to be added in here. You could do this on the PC side, but it was kind of cool to do it in the firmware. And because this is connected to the network, and these are UDP packets coming in, they can come in out of sequence. You could miss them. And they're also can come in clumps in time. So you need some way to buffer these up and sort of put them in the right order. So basically you have this 21 packet thing, and you just take these packets and put them in order and then send it before you send it to the radio. Because the radio wants these packets every 20 milliseconds. These are coming in who knows when. Analog processing, this is looking at the data coming in from the analog devices chip, the analog FM. Basically do a DC removal. It's sampled at 32 kilohertz, which is a lot higher than what you need for voice, but implement a noise squelch. So you look at the high frequency audio stuff, high pass filter it, do a noise squelch, because there's no voice energy, not a whole lot of voice energy above, you know, 4 or 5 kilohertz. But with the way FM works, as soon as you get a little bit of a carrier, the noise really goes down. So this is a real sensitive squelch. You could use RSSI, but this was easier to do. On the other side, you decimate by 4 to get 8,000 hertz sample rate, and that's the audio out. Those samples can get sent back to the host. Also added, just for, because I had room, put a DTMF tone decoder in there that's monitoring that too, so it'll actually decode DTMF tones. Transmit, pretty simple, you just take the samples coming from the PC at 8 kilohertz and runs it through the linearization table and sends them to the DAC. The user interface to the DVAP, I know you're going to boo, it's closed firmware source code. Reason is this is a commercial product, and maybe when it gets toward end of life, you can open that up. But when you put a lot of money and stuff into a product, and you spent tens of thousands of dollars for, NRE and test, regulatory testing, all this stuff, you don't want to, somebody just take all your stuff and build something, put you out of business, and you lose your house. To make up for it, though, the actual interface is open, totally documented very well, so it's anybody can talk to this thing. Simple protocol, basically over the serial port at 230 kbits, And again, like I said, it uses the FTDI that everybody uses. Typical protocol example, real simple. First byte says how many bytes are in the message, and then this is a request for the name of the device. The dongle comes back and says, here's who I am, I'm a DVAP dongle. It sends an ASCII string. The header packet, you're looking at all the different header information, and that's sent, that's for transmit or receive. Voice data, here's the bytes in the voice data. On the internet side, they add sequence numbers. You know, frame position, sequence. There's also a stream ID. And that's important on the network because you can have all these UDP streams, multiple people, and you got to keep track of who's who, because it's just, when it's voice data, you don't know who's talking unless you know the stream ID. So it's a 16-bit random number. Every time you transmit, it creates a new stream ID. Another message comes back continuously from it that tells you the RSSI and DBM. And also when you're transmitting it, there's a buffer. It tells you how many buffers are available to send. So you can actually fill this thing up and get ahead of it so it doesn't run out of data while it's transmitting. Auxiliary modes has a mode where you can tell it start, end frequency. It'll scan and make a little spectrum analyzer out of it. CW carrier test, that's useful for setting the frequency. I won't go into these other things. Now there are a couple open source programs up on SourceForge. These are written in Qt. This one shows off using it as a band scope, basically scanning, here's all looking at all 2 meters, and the red is a peak hold. This I just let run several hours on an external antenna, and you can see these are all the repeaters popping up here in the Atlanta area. So it's kind of a useful tool. Also, you can see the spur, internal spurs. This thing has, there's several frequencies that has an internal spur, and this will tell you where not to, what frequencies not to use or avoid. Also, you can do things, you can set the frequency calibration, so you can, if you have a frequency counter, you can go and adjust it, and this is stored in E squared. There's some other modes I'll skip. Here's a little utility again, open source, to exercise the analog FM side. And here it showed displays the DTMF decoding. Also, I don't know why I do things, but I added a CTCSS decoder. It has like 41 Goertzel filters running, looking at all the possible things and a display, which so may be useful if you want to see if your HT is putting out the right tones. I'll go through these real fast. This is just test data. I'll stop here. This is probably why you may not want to take the DVAP and hook it to a kilowatt amplifier and next door to your guy doing EME on 2 meters. I'm comparing the 92AD, which is their ICOM handheld, versus the DVAP on 2 meters. Now look, I've normalized, they're both the same power, they're both disk carriers, CW carriers, but look at the noise. This is like, there's 20 dB, almost 20 dB, no more noise, phase noise, and mostly probably due to the fact that the oscillator's on the chip. I mean, everything's on this little chip, so it's really hard to create high Q inductors and stuff. Same way, 70 centimeters is a little better, but the close in is worse, but the outside here, and this is 2 meg wide. When you zoom in, the DVAP actually looks a little better, but I think this is because, I mean, to do this carrier, all I can do is put it in FM mode and key up, but when you're in that mode, there's probably just audio noise getting into the microphone, creating some stuff there. This is the GMSK transmit signal. I'm just put them on top of each other to show that, yes, indeed, basically the modulation is the exact same thing, the GMSK. This is not because of the modulation. Again, this is the phase noise of the DVAP. And this is what broke my back for like three years. This is the harmonics generated by the, this is the 2 meter, this is the carrier at 2 meters, these are the second, third, fourth, and fifth harmonics. This is after I put the right filters in, and basically they're down on the noise. The 70 centimeters are the ones that gave me grief. Now they're tame. They're down, you know, 90 dB down. Earlier, before I found, I was told how to do the right filtering. The third harmonic was up here at like minus 50. It was horrible. There was like a resonance on the board that was just awful above a gigahertz. Regulatory testing. This is the kind of junk you have to do for when you have an actual commercial product. It's very expensive. And in fact, this is probably the single most expensive thing in development of this product. You know, all the prototypes, all that is nothing compared to the cost of doing all these mainly European regulatory stuff. And the user gets no value out of that either, which is kind of frustrating. So, conclusion, DVAP is a useful device for what it does, low, short range, low power transceiver. I hesitate to say put it on a amplifier and try to make it something it isn't. Doesn't mean you can't, but it's not really advisable to try to extend it. For all your DVAP needs, there's DVAPdongle.com, which has all the latest software and stuff. And I'll thank these three guys. These are the guys that set me straight and kind of snickered at me and when they looked at the board and took it in their lab and actually fixed the RF problems. So my conclusion is I should stay below 100 megs. You know, I'll be safe. So I have any questions?
Quick question. But in the FCC spec, 40.
Isn't the FCC spec for spurious emissions only 40 dB below the carrier?
FCC is great. It's the European stuff. I think it's 50 and maybe 60. And depending on what test lab you talk to, they interpret things differently. And the amateur—they're not real familiar with amateur radio stuff. But
it sounded like you were within spec. You're just trying to be cleaner than spec.
No, well, I guess it just bothered me that. Here's what blew my mind is I had all these humps at around gigahertz. I took a piece of bus wire right across the end of the SMA connector, right next to the ground, soldered across there, put it on the analyzer. Of course, 400 megs was gone, 450 was gone, the carrier. But there are all these three harmonics up there at a gig. And what it was actually some sort of board resonance on the connector. So I don't know, I just didn't feel safe.
Maybe I just missed the point here, but the analog feature you talk about, how would you use that other than for testing your microphone or something? Is that like Echo Star capable?
Or? The idea was maybe an Echo, do the equivalent on
Echo Link. Right.
The problem is Echo Link's closed, so, you know, how do you get into that without getting the author involved? So maybe he would.
I was wondering if there's an application I missed here.
No.
Okay. It's just fun.
Yeah, basically.
I know Robin would like it. He's a big analog man.
Yeah.
I have to tell a group my glee is talking to Robin Cutshaw on Simplex FM analog occasionally.
Okay. That's about all the time we have. Thank you.